Hello everyone, we're very pleased to welcome you to the 7th Grand Chandler Seminar of 2023. This seminar is titled, as I'm sure you all know, Bridging the Divide Between Our Oceans and Society. Oceans have always been somewhat far removed from us, and yet they are vital to sustaining all life on Earth. In the wake of World Oceans Day, which was yesterday, we're reminded of the multitude of threats that face our oceans, from pollution to overfishing, which ultimately might lead to widespread ecosystem collapse. It is thus more important than ever to try and bridge this gap between our oceans and human society, as in our engagement and investment as a society in the state of our oceans could be key to reversing our harmful impacts. So for today's seminar, we ask the question, why should we care? And more importantly, what can we do about it? In order to answer these questions, first, we have Mr. James Honeyborn, Creative Director of Freeborn Media. We have Dr. Selena Stead, Professor of Environmental Sciences at Leeds University. And we have Ms. Claire Moody, CEO of an NGO startup that works with plastic pollution. Unfortunately, our fourth speaker cannot be with us today due to health-related reasons. We are also joined by the chair of our discussion, Dr. David Marshall, Professor of Physical Oceanography at Oxford and Director of the DTP. We'll start off with introductions from each of our speakers, followed by a panel discussion, and we'll have time for questions and answers at the end. So please join me in welcoming our panel for the day.
So thank you, Victoria, for the introductions, and indeed to all of the organisers for putting together this amazing programme. As the academic director of the Doctoral Training Partnership here, in Oxford, and say this is a really special series of events that we've been holding every week in the summer term. And the program today, I think, is absolutely phenomenal. So I'm really looking forward to it. So let's get started straight away. So our first speaker person to introduce themselves is James. So do you want to come up? And I assume someone's going to play.
Hi everyone, happy Friday afternoon, thanks for coming. My name is James Honeyborn. I am a wildlife filmmaker and I'll just give you a little bit of background on me, and then I'm going to play a short clip from probably the most relevant series that you might have seen to do with this, which is Blue Planet 2 that I made we started in 2013, came out in 2017. So it's a little bit old now, but our next one will be out soon. Anyway, my sort of love of the ocean started when I was a kid. My grandparents lived in the Channel Islands, and every holidays we go out there. And I found that I was most connected to the, not to the sandy beaches, but to the rocky shore. I just love the rock pools and the kelp, and it all seemed such a magical, incredible place as a kid growing up. I read biology at University up in Newcastle, and by that time I was already a researcher at the BBC Natural History Unit in the holidays, doing sort of holiday cover on their library and things. And eventually I worked my way up and got to make a Wildlife in One with Sir David Attenborough, and the first film I chose to make was on brown pelicans, the plunge diving birds that you might encounter across the Americas. And that was my first foray into underwater filmmaking. I was then lucky enough to work with the world champion freediver, Tania Streeter, who had the absolute world record for deep diving. She could hold her breath for a phenomenally long time, still can. Has a silver wetsuit. And we took a diving with whales and sharks and various things around the world. And it was amazing to see, sort of, first time we really got to see a person against some of the size of these really big animals. And that was, you know, fun TV. That led to a few other series, and then Blue Planet 2. I also did a thing called Big Blue Live, which was on the BBC about 5 or 6 years ago. And that was fun because we based ourselves in Monterey Bay and had the challenge of doing 3 live broadcasts from the Pacific coast. And by the end of it, we knew this bay so well from the air that we were able to bring audiences live great white sharks, live blue whales even, which was just amazing, and sort of saw the whole incredible feast feasting event that happens when the Sardians come in there and sort of in fall time. And that was great because, again, what I'm trying to do is help audiences connect and care about the underwater world, I suppose. And it's something that I'm still trying to do in the work that we do. We have an amazing team of divers and marine biologists and filmmakers. We're now making a series that's going to come out next year on Netflix. Making it for the last 4 years. It's called Our Oceans. So watch out for that. And we get to work alongside some of the big exploration vessels, which is exciting in terms of going deeper with submarines and things. And as well as that, I'm lucky enough to be on the advisory panel for the UN Decade of Restoration. So I'm just trying to help find ways of always trying to tell new stories and helping people engage more with nature. So that's really what we try and do in our business. And I'm just going to play a clip just to remind you of Blue Planet 2 and the impact. This is a film that was made by ITV, I think, shortly after it came out, because they kindly gave us an award for impact. I think it's kind of relevant to today's conversation. So here we are.
The oceans, seemingly limitless, invoke in us a sense of awe and wonder, and also sometimes fear. In the course of making Blue Planet 2, we've explored every corner of the underwater world. We've encountered extraordinary animals. And discovered new insights into how life is lived beneath the waves. For years, we thought that the oceans were so vast that nothing we could do could have an effect upon them. But now we know that was wrong. It's now clear that our actions are having a significant impact on the world's oceans. Plastic has become an integral part of our daily lives, but every year some 8 million tons of it ends up in the ocean, and there it can be lethal.
Audiences across the country, glued to Blue Planet 2, have been starkly reminded of the problems of plastics pollution.
The problem was vividly highlighted in the BBC's recent Blue Planet 2 series, which was public service broadcasting at its finest. The plan for England, which we're publishing today, sets out the action of government.
We are at a unique stage in our history. Never before have we had such an awareness of what we are doing to the planet. And never before have we had the power to do something about that. Surely we have a responsibility to care for our blue planet. The future of humanity, and indeed all life on Earth, now depends on us.
Okay, thank you, James. That was fantastic. Our next speaker is going to introduce themselves is Selena. So stage is yours.
Thank you and good afternoon. Gosh, that was pretty awesome. How do you follow something like that? My name is Selina Stead. I'm the Executive Dean for the Faculty Environment at the University of Leeds. I'm also the Chief Scientific Advisor for UK Government for the Marine Management Organisation. And I'm going to, when I saw this question, what the focus of this session was, I was so excited. I cleared my diary and I'm really delighted to be here. So if I can just get the slides up, I will give you, I have to make sure I don't get carried away. So I'm going to somehow do the story of my life to answer the homework question in 4 or 5 minutes as quickly as I could. So why should we care? I think it's quite important sometimes how we connect to that, the question to the seas and the oceans. And I just wanted to briefly explain that, like a lot of people, I was taken to the coast or the fishing boats. I played in rock pools. And for me, what made a real difference, there was a film in the 70s that you may or may not remember. So like a little audience participation, I'd like you all to close your eyes and just see what comes to mind, and I will explain the relevance. So close your eyes and just tell me what comes to mind. Okay, I'll stop it there. But I think, as James said, it is about an emotional connection. And for me, unlike wanting to stay out of the water, I really wanted to jump in. So at 12 years old, when we went to America to visit my mum's pen friend, and she said, well, what do you want to be when you grow up, Selina? I said, well, I'm really interested in the sea. So she said, well, there's a local professor, Eugenie Clark. Why don't you give her a ring? She's in the local university in Washington. So I did. They said, she's a bit busy, but she'll call you back. She called me back, and at 12 years old, for her to speak for about 2 hours, telling me, giving me advice, was really, really quite inspirational at the time, even though I didn't realise. So by age 14, I picked Bangor University in Wales. At the time, it was the only university that could do marine biology and oceanography, and I was interested in both. And I wanted to be a shark biologist. So what you can see there is that's an X-ray machine from a breast cancer unit, and my Skylaurinus canicula, the dogfish, is anesthetized. And I was looking at feeding, I was looking at barium sulfate to try and understand the relationship between food and appetite, because I was interested in food webs and linking. If you knew these apex predators are so important, that's an indicator of the health of the ocean. And I stayed on at Bangor to do a fisheries MSc, fisheries biology and management, but it was very heavy on the modelling. And the graph here, is fundamental to all fisheries management. We measure something called maximum sustainable yield, but it's very much about the environmental, the number of fish in the sea. We also look at the maximum economic yield, hence the dollars there. I couldn't find pounds sterling. But what I started to ask the question is, well, what about the social pillar? There's three pillars to sustainability: environmental, economic, and social. And I started to ask that question. And then I moved up to the University of Aberdeen to work on salmon. These are actually wild salmon, you can see just here, from the River Dee by Balmoral. And I continued looking at the behavior, looking at the feeding, the physiology. But I was the only marine scientist then in two social science departments. And I started again to understand the relationship between socioeconomics. But what I also found is that the perception of salmon and salmon farming, mine was on the wild salmon, people have very negative views, and I started to understand about perceptions. And then I did some work with Scottish Government, because my PhD was joint between Scottish Government and the zoology department. And there was a lot of conflict between the fishermen and between government. Fishermen didn't want the scientists to come on the board, so it's going to affect their quotas. And I learned you can have the best science in the world, you can have the best models,
But if people don't believe, if they don't follow the rules and regulations and you get no compliance, it's going to make no difference. So that's when I got really interested in rule breaking. And then I moved to the University of Newcastle. I think it was 12 years in Aberdeen, diving January, 4 degrees at the surface. I was specialised in tropical coastal management. And some of the first work I did very briefly was in the Seychelles, because we're an island nation. I've always been fascinated about our connection with the sea. But what I learned from the Seychelles, you can just see very briefly there, the corals, parts of it, over 90% are bleached. And then when you get hurricanes, it soon goes to the rubble where you have nothing there. And given many of the communities are very socially, economically dependent on fisheries for food and income, I started to work with local fishing communities and to understand the importance and to explain that for government. But there was the Black Swan event, because I went in 2005 after a bleaching event. We had the economic financial crisis in 2008. And then tourists didn't go. There was real concerns about the seafood supplies. And what they said to me 10 years later is, Selena, we have a real problem. We need to regrow the corals and we need to offer alternative sources of food. So they asked me to look at mariculture and specialize in sea cucumbers. So looking at low trophic species that have different ecological functions and that can improve the health of the oceans. So part of my work is working on fisheries and aquaculture. And then I was really proud to have led a Queen's Anniversary Prize, where we won an award showing that aquaculture is really important for conservation. There are parts of our oceans that are so damaged they can't repair. So that's what I'm working on at the moment in nature policy. And the very final thing I just wanted to say is that I learned that we can understand social, economic dependence. You have to link that with the health of the oceans, but actually you need the political will. You need to have it in the policy so that the resources is made available for regulations and conservation. So that's very much my brief life story. And then just coming to the question about why, well, if we don't have healthy oceans, we don't have a healthy planet, we don't have healthy people. So for me, it's very, very simple. And when I think of my children, I was going to ask you all to guess how many sharks are surrounding. That is my youngest son. We did win the competition of the best picture in his rugby kit. However, there are 23 circling sharks there from some of our research. But for me, it's about the compelling stories. It's about the narrative, using the evidence and the science. And I do that both with government and both with our students. So I'll stop there before I get more carried away. I'm really looking forward to the rest of the session. So thank you.
So thank you, Selena, for sharing your story. That was fantastic. And so last but not least, Claire, your turn.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming and for having me along. It's quite exciting to be here. My name is Claire Moody and I'm the CEO of Plastic Free North Devon, which is a small but mighty environmental charity based in the heart of North Devon. But I always think it's quite important to point out, I'm also an environmentalist, I'm a mother, I'm a surfer, I'm a diver, I'm a wild swimmer, I'm a mountain biker. And I think one of the things I think when we come into this conversation is really important, that it's not how we operate in our communities as citizens, isn't just about our job titles. We have kind of tendrils of impact in everything that we do. And I think I feel quite proud of my job title now, but I wasn't quite there, but it was all the volunteering, all those kind of added impact things that I did that have really built and I suppose really made my journey a really special one. So these are kind of a snapshot of my kind of pivotal moments in terms of how I got to run Plastic Free North Devon. So like I said, it set up in 2017 as a community group, actually off the back of the Blue Planet series in 2017, Blue Planet 2. And it was also aligned with the Surfaces Against Sewage Plastic Free Communities program. And it was, I was saying to James earlier that when we kind of launched the program in Braunton, we had literally standing room only. It was such, it literally blew the whole series. And I think the whole idea of a toolkit and being able to take action on plastic itself really brought the community to us. But just since I'm going to go talk a bit more about plastic in a minute, but just in terms of how I got there, I grew up on the coast in North Devon, spent my life rolling around in rock pools like some of the other guys here, Channels Beach in particular, if you ever get a chance to go. Very old Victorian kind of man-made pools, so amazing for rock pools. But my family never really had any money, so I actually never really travelled. And I had this when I got to 18 and I finished my A-levels, I had this kind of boiling, bubbling up of wanting to experience and explore other ocean environments. And I spent 2 years kind of on my extended gap years doing that, and I learned to dive. I did lots of volunteering on different conservation projects, and then I finally took to my degree at Cardiff University and I studied marine geography there for 3 years. And again, when I graduated there, I was I wasn't quite ready to go into, I suppose, a career per se. I was very excited about, still had the travel bug. I still liked the idea of being somewhere warm and studying the ocean and being outside, essentially. So I went from conservation project to conservation project, not getting paid very much money. But actually on this picture here, this was my last job I did kind of, I suppose, underwater. And this, I was working as a scientific diver on a Seychelles, in the Seychelles as a coral reef restoration diver, which is probably one of my proudest moments because I was actually paid to do it, which was great, which is kind of unheard of in your early stages of conservation career. And I had a pivotal moment there. I was actually due to start my master's down at Exeter. You probably don't remember this, but at the time you couldn't actually get like loans to do your master's at the time. You kind of had to get these kind of, they didn't have like kind of like student loans, and I couldn't really afford to do it. So in the end, I actually postponed it and I actually went back to my roots. Well, not roots, but marine geography, for those of you that don't know, is kind of, you can study hydrography as well. So a lot of the guys that I went to university with ended up being hydrographic surveyors or went into engineering. So I kind of fielded, went and was kind of looking at that. And this is the picture on the right hand side, is actually, I worked as an offshore surveyor for a company called Guardline. And we did lots of underwater surveying for cable routes and for the oil and gas industry as well. And I did a 2 year stint offshore and I absolutely loved being at sea, and we saw blue whales. I do 2 or 3 months at a time. An incredible experience, but I definitely knew it wasn't quite in line with my values and obviously some of the companies we were working with. It was a real kind of step away from what I was doing. And then I came home, and I actually ended up being, because I really wanted to, I think when I was in my late 20s by that point, and I really had established myself in North Devon. I wanted to be in North Devon. And it's quite hard to find conservation-based work, as you guys will probably know. So I ended up doing my teacher training in geography, which was quite exciting. So I ended up doing my geography teacher training. But while I was doing my training, I actually got pregnant with my lovely little girl, which was slightly unplanned. And I was never very, I knew I would be never very good at being on maternity leave. I wasn't very good at sitting still. I always had been spinning many plates. And it was on my maternity leave that I actually set up Plastic Free North Devon as a community group with a kind of other few volunteers. And but I suppose just to touch on that as well, when I actually came back to North Devon and I based myself when I was offshore, it was really interesting because I had realized I'd spent my life, or not my life, but maybe my early 20s kind of traveling the world and seeing all this amazing stuff, but I'd actually kind of failed to kind of really explore and realize what was on my doorstep. So I started looking at volunteer opportunities locally. So with Surfers Against Sewage, I became a rep for them and still am. I did some volunteer for our local biosphere in ARMB. And they're all skills that really helped build up kind of obviously setting up Plastic Free North Devon. So Plastic Free North Devon in 2018 actually became its own charity. Actually in 2019 it became its own charity. We've now got 5 part-time members of staff. And the whole emphasis behind it is protect and improve our environment through community-led action. So it's really kind of rooted in grassroots activism. And essentially what we're always trying to do is create toolkits and facilitate the community to do the right thing. So we went from doing beach cleans and talking to businesses about reducing plastic, but education, that's obviously probably from what I've just talked about, really sits at the heart of what we do as well. So we, I actually took a bunch of kids to Lundy two days ago, and that top right hand picture there is actually one of the Atlantic grey seals, and that's me snorkeling with them. And the whole idea of that particular project was actually to how do we share? So a lot of the kids, and I'm sure we find this in Cornwall and other places, is a lot of the kids that live in that area actually don't have access to the beach and maybe haven't actually ever visited. We've got kids that live 10, 15 minutes away from the beach that have never visited. So the idea around this program is exploring the biosphere with them, getting some see of what's underwater, and hopefully the idea that they'll want to protect it. But we also introduce them to local experts. We talk to them about volunteering and careers. So they have a real good, yes, they learn about it and they fall in love with it, but they also have a real clear pathway for how they might want to get involved. And we also run, we set up toy shed. We've got about five of these. This picture here is share sheds that are dotted around our beaches now. This idea around trying to encourage people to buy, and not to buy, sorry, to reuse rather than buying. We built a water bar that we can put in events so people don't have to sell plastic, single-use plastic water bottles. This year, we've got repair cafes running right the way across North Devon. We've got, I think, running in five locations. We've got one happening tomorrow. And the whole idea around that is essentially providing a service for people to kind of take action on some of the issues that we're facing. And I think the doom and gloom around some of the climate and ecological issues that face us can be quite, quite frightening, I suppose, and also quite debilitating. But one of the things that I've really felt in the last few months for me personally is this kind of idea of hope. And I feel like there's a lot of action going on. And I went to the XR, some of you might have gone to the XR big one a few months ago, where 70,000 people joined on the streets of London. And then again on the Saturday, over 100,000 people, lots of people, cross-generational, young people, old people, people from organisations. And there were picket lines outside every government organisation, every government office around Parliament. And it was fascinating. And that wasn't really reported in the news at all, apart from the fact that it might affect the marathon. And that really gave me hope, because I realised there were so many people taking action, not just in my local area, but right the way across the country. So I suppose, yeah, this is what we do in North Devon, and we're building and we're trying to harness that whole idea of providing tools for people to do the right thing. But yeah, that's me.
So thank you, Claire, and perhaps all of the panelists. It's what an amazing collection of speakers we have today. So I'm going to invite everyone up now, and we're going to have about 25 minutes for panel discussion, and then we'll open to the floor for the last 25 minutes or so. Okay, so we're going to kick off with a rapid-fire question for everyone. So I want you to try and keep the answers really short, one or two sentences, because we've only got about 25 minutes. Whoops. And I want to ask a few other questions. So based on your experience, why are the oceans relevant and important to our society? Who wants to kick off?
Claire?
Okay.
Yep.
So ultimately our health and well-being depends on a healthy ocean, and over 50% of our oxygen comes from the oceans. And yeah, keeping it short.
For me, with growing populations, terrestrial sources can't meet the protein needs, and therefore seafood is probably one of our best options. And for some communities, they have no other alternative than fishing, so that's really the one.
Yeah, I think the oceans are the planet's life support system. They are, the way they give us our weather, they distribute fresh water around the world constantly. They redistribute heat around the world, which is actually really important. They do so many fundamental things for us. They are absolutely, interconnecting the whole planet, and that is a sort of fundamental truth. So we can't really exist in the way we do today without them.
Thank you. And as a physical oceanographer, I might just add, the other 2.5 meters of the ocean contain as much heat as the entire atmosphere. And I think the upper 100 meters of the ocean as much carbon as the entire atmosphere. So you really can't think about the Earth system climate without thinking about the Earth system.
Write that down.
Going to get that script. Okay, so the second question, and we'll take slightly longer, but not too long answers. Do you feel there are any major misconceptions or gaps in current conversations that prevent us from developing a more sustainable relationship with our emissions? Maybe Selena, do you want to kick off?
Okay. So for me, it's really understanding the social side, people's connection with the seas, because we have to understand people's attitudes, which influence their perceptions, which influence their behaviour. That's what's going to change, whether it's plastics, whether it's over-exploitation. And I think we can do a lot more to really understand how we influence positive behaviour. I'm very interested in rule breaking, but I work with communities and get them to help make the rules. The other that I would say very briefly, the work that we are doing on positive nature mariculture, looking at how we can rebuild. We don't hear so much in conversations about those kinds of projects. I'll stop just there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, James.
So in terms of sort of gaps, misconceptions, I think the interconnectedness of it is a sort of, we don't really fully understand that or appreciate that in ways that we should. You know, you can't have effective governance of the oceans without appreciating that everything moves within the ocean. Everything's on the move. If you pollute one area, it will move. You overfish one area, will have consequences somewhere else. You know, I think the gap in our appreciation of interconnectedness is really important. Also, the gap in our knowledge generally, there's still so much we don't know about the oceans and the way they work. Just look at how little we understand the deep ecosystems where we might have deep sea mining. You know, and how can we touch on until we understand? You know, that we have huge knowledge. And then finally, I think the other gap that I consider a lot is the empathy gap. You know, how do we care about something that feels over there, it feels irrelevant to our daily lives? How do we make it feel vitally relevant? You know, how can we connect and care with a world that can be alien or slimy or scary, unforgiving? You know, it's there's lots of reasons not to, and yet somehow we need to. And bridging that empathy gap occupies my time.
Thank you. Have a clear.
Does that work?
Okay. I was on a panel with the Beach Guardian the day, and she's made a really good point. She said, not everyone loves the beach. Like you were saying, no, not everyone looks amazing. Not maybe because say, like mountains, we never back, but they never actually connected with it. And I think only half the half of the population in the world lives around within 100 kilometers of the coast, and everyone else very much in them. But like James was saying, that whole one ocean is our life support system. When you're not living in the ocean, living next to the ocean, obviously, the health and well-being of those people living in that is dependent on that. So how do we make that connection? I think that's still a really hard thing to, yeah, I think it's a really hard thing to overcome. And one of the things that we find, even in North Devon, like I say, we have kids that haven't even visited the beach, and they get a little connected. They don't understand why the ocean is important. And yes, and what we also find is lots of education goes on within primary schools, but actually it seems to kind of tick off on the secondary school. So, and this whole idea of, you know, when schools are talking about their values, that really environmental sustainability and this whole idea of ocean protection really needs to be central and core to those values. So that when we're talking about the teaching subject, it's all interrelated rather than these admirable things that we're going to learn about conservation and we're going to talk about spatial physical geography. It's kind of this whole idea of connecting that in the way that we teach kids.
Okay, thank you. One of my mind's target this next question is, which is, what hurdles the multi-scale and transboundary nature of the oceans pose to future conservation and management efforts?
Thank you for that nice, easy question. Friday afternoon. For me, the biggest hurdle is we've got to have cooperation between different nations, many species, whether my mother sharks, cetaceans, they don't recognise boundaries. They cross boundaries, some of them go from many, many, many thousands of miles. So it is so important that we get that political will from different countries coming together. But I think also it's about what I describe multi-level governance. It's really important that people connected at the local level, that people's dependence, understanding that there is that link between local dependence on our resources as well as nationally. And that's where I spend a lot more of my time looking at science policy and how we can make sure that we get the link up between the science and the conservation and the management.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone else want to contribute? Or I wonder specifically about the governance of the sea, and, which I think poses particular challenges. Anyone wants to pick up on?
But I just echo, it's a global issue with global consequences. And yeah, we try and manage it at a local level, which seems ironic, really.
Yes. I think there's quite, if I may just maybe perhaps give a little example, if there is some time. So some of the research I've done, let's take Seychelles. I would speak to the ministers and they would say, well, yes, the Seychelles in particular is so, the most important is the health of the environment for the fisheries, especially tuna fisheries, because they're big two economic pillars, tourism and fisheries. However, the economic prosperity comes first over and above the environment or from a government perspective. But then from local people, the social benefits, the cultural benefits that you can't really put a price on. So when we're talking about governance, we often talk about formal regulations, we talk about monetary, but actually it's the non-monetary, the valuation, and we don't capture that very well in policy, but that's the most powerful. Mm.
So thank you. I wonder, Claire, I might ask you, what are the economic, societal and ecological consequences if public engagement on the oceans does not improve?
That sounds like a very good question.
It is. Well, afternoon question.
Battle class, I think people don't really gauge how urgent this is, then essentially it's all out very people, I think, in some cases. And I think we've got some really tricky challenges there. And I think to James, about 4 years ago, I went to an SAS conference and he said something that really stuck with me. He said, we're the first generation to make something about it. I'm going to the last generation to do something about it. And it really stuck with me in my work and how I talk to others. But also, we don't really want to put it on the young people either. It's all of our issue. And locally, we try and do lots of action to help people live more sustainably and particularly and whatever. But the challenge is actually taking it up a level in terms of, in order to combat that stuff, we have to organise locally, we have to be creative, we have to think, because the government aren't putting legislation quick enough in place to combat most of these issues. So slow, just personally, I mean, still 7 years, you haven't got it, so slow. So what can we do creatively, collaboratively, locally to really harness that? And I think as citizens, we have to kind of think of ourselves as a verb, you know, we are doing and we are operating within our communities rather than kind of passive and kind of letting someone else think that. We have to engage everyone to take action on it. I think the only way we can do that.
Thank you. Wanda Jones, if you have any thoughts, no question.
No, I mean, we were talking about our work the other day, and one of our researchers said it threatens the very fabric of life as we know it. that's a big statement. But I guess it's true. Yep.
So I feel a bit silly asking this question, given the amazing work you guys are doing, but what have we done so far to increase public engagement with ocean matters, and how successful do you think that's been? James?
I think from NGO work through to influencing governments, you know, there's clearly some success, but it's drop in the ocean, isn't that, compared to what we need to do? I think it seems to me, I'm lucky I get to meet lots of people who love the sea and the ocean, and a lot of people who take direct action and try and make meaningful change. And you do get a feeling that there is a sort of groundswell of that growing, perhaps. There's an awareness that's growing. But gosh, sometimes it feels like too little too late in terms of some of the issues that we're facing. But what we do know about the ocean, which is amazing, is that if you take the pressures off it, it can recover really fast. And if you can see, great recovery. So much of that we shouldn't lose sight of hope. I don't believe it's opium, someone put it the other day. I do believe genuinely that we should be hopeful for to be able to make change and for that change to indeed be meaningful. I'm just also really impressed by some of the individuals who are campaigning. You might have seen some of the river pollution campaigning that's been happening lately. Everything that happens in rivers ends up in the sea, of course, pretty much. That's something that's clearly very much in the sort of news spotlight at the moment. From our point of view in media, it's really about effective storytelling, and we have to challenge ourselves as storytellers to engage people the best we can, because the more we can help people connect to care with this world, the easier it will be. What we saw on Blue Planet 2 was an emotional response from the audience who had come to feel connected to the series. And we never said, oh, you must go and clean the beaches, but people did, because they made it like the NGOs, but also because there was just this sort of, people could see a tangible problem and they wanted to make the world better. So I think we should also have faith in the human response to want to do that.
So thank you, Claire. You're on the front line.
Yeah. Like I said, it's kind of, I think the last 3 or 4 years we've been really focused on more like individual actions. So remember your reusable water, shop locally, refill, and all that sort of thing. And that's been really engaging, but people feel like they can take action and they can kind of do their thing and then they can kind of carry on merrily with their lives. And I think that's the bit that I think needs to alter, in the sense that the individual incrementalism isn't really solving the problem. So how do we get those people to take stronger and more powerful action? And I think part of the problem there is that we have to give people something useful to do. So for instance, an example, a few weeks ago, we actually ran a theft against the bridge protest in North Devon on Green Beach. I ended up meeting together 3 or 4 days before. We still had over 60 people turn up. And it was, if there's a problem and they can see a tangible way of taking action, they will take action. But unless you facilitate your community to be able to get involved and be empowered to do that, we're not stepping up that level of action hard enough, I suppose. So I think it's about tools to do the right thing. And with, like, I was talking about earlier, you can still walk in Reading Supermarket in North Devon, shortly around the country. And I think I counted 20 kids' magazines covered in plastic and plastic toys. And we already know there's a number of problems with that. Stuff that we should have got rid of 5, 6 years ago, and it's still there, it's still making that. Disposable barbecues, £3-4, they're causing wildfires, a whole bag of wood for fire last year, and they're still being sold. And I think it's the government and the legislation that needs to trickle down with the community. And if the government aren't doing it, then we need to petition locally and be really hot on that in all our communities.
Yeah, thank you. Selina?
Thank you. I think, again, I say engagement is a consultation, and you have to really be able to identify shared values with people to get that shared understanding, because if you don't have those shared values, it's quite difficult to come with your goals. And so I think one of the challenges I find, and also when I'm working in different departments in government, is a lot of it is very terrestrial. And we sometimes, those of us that love the sea and the ocean, can't keep us out of it. But many of the countries and similar here don't know what is, it's invisible, don't see underneath, especially around the UK, because we don't quite have the visibility. Some of the countries that I work in, but I think we sometimes forget, it's almost a leap of faith, which is why I'm really keen that we have more underwater cameras that are in schools. There's a lot to be said about the education. And I think also that point about, well, how do you get people engaged? That first work I did in, say, Shell, was like, Lena, people are breaking rules about marine protected areas. You know, we can't understand them. Can you find out why? And what they told me is that the fishermen said, well, nobody asks us about the boundaries. And they built that bridge, and it costs us so much time and money to go around here. And they said, and we see tourists, and they're throwing litter, they're throwing plastics, which I come back to the enforcement. So a lot of the work I do, I go into the communities, I understand it from the people that can be impacted by the rules, from the government, is it enforcement? It's often quite complicated. So I think, you know, when we're doing engagement, if we're going to be effective, we have to understand how people value the oceans, what it means to them, and focus on outcomes rather than outputs.
So thank you. You've already answered part of my next question, which is, so what can we do in the future to improve public engagement as policymakers, but also in a university of academics and as scientific communicators? So maybe James.
I think one of the things we have to try and do is help people understand the science is clear on a lot of this, and helping communicate that feels really important. And I think engaging a sort of diverse perspective across it is also really important. We need to recognize the diversity in which people experience the ocean and live with the ocean, to the point, and to force, and if we include that wide variety of views, we will have forged stronger connections and have new understandings. So that feels important to me. And what we will do in our little corner of it all will be to just kind of try and keep telling stories that do reach people, that connect and care, and how people feel it. You know, for me, one of the transformative moments of making Blue Planet 2 is when we met this little tuskfish, a little fish that sits on the Great Barrier Reef. And we'd heard that it would crack open clams. And this particular tuskfish, the one that we filmed, was within 200 yards of Lizard Island, which is a very famous marine search. And yet no one that had ever clocked this behavior actually happened. And when we told the story, you suddenly got this experience of looking at a fish in his eyes and realizing, gosh, you're so much more capable and clever than we thought. It's using an anvil, coral as an anvil, to crack. It's amazing. And I think it also, just the fact that we didn't know about that until then, is just a really good reminder of how much we don't know and how engaging these characters can be, and sea life can be, and the ocean can be, once we get to know about it. So that's what we're going to try and keep doing.
So perhaps before I move on to Claire and Selena, just ask a very brief follow-up question as a physical oceanographer. So, I mean, I think you do an amazing job on the Blue Planet programs in communicating the science and what's not known as well. In my field, we quite often, it's probably less now than it used to be. We'd read every other Sunday about the Gulf Stream collapsing and icebergs coming to the English Channel. And then, of course, there was the day after tomorrow. What's your feeling about these sort of Hollywood productions and, shall we say, sort of sensationalism, which is often not rooted in hard science, although there's an element, a grain of truth underpinning it? Do you think that's productive or counterproductive?
I think within entertainment you can have provocations, things which get a conversation going. I think actually catalyzing the conversation is a really important thing to do. We obviously try to allow our documentaries as factually as we can, because people expect them to be factually correct. We have multiple sources for every single fact, and they're all double, triple checked. So we certainly try and get it. I do think within the broader remit of entertainment, provocations isn't a bad thing, gets people going, and we need to be able to talk about this stuff.
And it has helped to fund the monitoring system.
Well, there we go. So
for the whole 20 years.
So also, you know, we have to reach multiple audiences, multiple communities, you know, in multiple ways, of which those would be one.
Okay, Clem, returning to the original question, so what can we do in the future to improve like engagement?
I think as I work in my regional experience, because that's where I work best, that's where I feel like I can use the best voice on this, is that opening the door program that I mentioned, where we take kids, you know, kids that may be struggling in school or suffering from mental health issues, or are actually just really passionate about the environment. We get this really dynamic group of people, and we explore the bias with them, and we introduce them to experts, and we take them on a journey, and we kind of then we continue this journey with them. So after their 6 weeks are up, they've been to London with us, done whatever. We then have these kind of rolling TED talk monthly things where we get them to watch a film. We have a space where they can come together and discuss. And I think at the moment we're only running that through schools, but I think that level of that experience, if we could give that to more children, you know, it's not. And there's also, and I think it's something to note, when there is a literally a mental health crisis going on in young people, we actually had a complaint about some of the content that we delivered to a primary school a couple of months ago, and actually by the wife of one of my trustees, which didn't go down too well. But it was really interesting because these kids have kind of grown up with this stuff, and they're super aware, but we're kind of going in and reinforcing it rather than telling them something new. So it's about how do we tell them a different story. So yes, the problem, how do we tell them a story of acts of hope and resilience and restoration and all that stuff. So we have to be really careful with our language as well going forward. I think the kind of period of trying to raise awareness, especially around inclusion, is kind of not over, it's still there, but now it's about how do we compensate, how do we make it better, and how do we not just leave it to the young people, make them feel like we're actually doing something useful about it.
Great, thank you. Selina.
Yeah, I agree about the education side. There's a lot more on ocean literacy now. Mm. And actually, if you still look traditionally, look at children's toys. How often do you see fishing boats or to do with the sea? It's often farms, it's still very terrestrial. So I think we can start from a much younger age about getting it into school curricula so that there is a pipeline going all the way through. But for me, some of my current and future focus, what I want to do is nature-based solutions. I've always had this question about why are some coastal communities more resilient than others? When I lived in Scotland, it's like, well, why is that? How come they're still doing fishing and they're not? And what is sustainable use of the coastal area? But you have to work with the communities and make the science fun, relatable. So, you know, we're going to be looking at harbour walls to look at, see how we can develop them for mariculture. Look at sea cucumbers. I don't hear enough about sea cucumbers. And even though, say, Prince Charles, King Charles, he didn't quite believe me when I said, look, we could have sea cucumber burgers in McDonald's or whatever if we diversified our food, which would take pressure off some of the other species. So for me, I think we have a really important role to make ocean science more relatable, to link in with the Blue Planet and other programs. But I'm also very interested in that coastal resilience and looking at the type of science where we can really enhance the health of local environments.
Okay, thank you. So I think we should open the floor now to the, if anyone wants to ask a question. So do we have any microphones? No.
Do you want to use this well?
We're going to share it. Sorry, I'm going to hold everything for a minute. Okay. Anyone to pick up the first question? So I see, wow, there's a start in the middle here.
Great. Hi. Thank you all. I applaud all the efforts to teach our children and also local communities. But to my mind, and I should say we live in New Zealand, on the beach, which is very important. The ocean is very important. For us, there's this huge, great sea out there, which has all kinds of political threats, overfishing from people who live a long way away, of many of the areas around us. How do we educate those people who are making the decisions to go into those places and take those resources or spoil those resources? How do we educate them so that, as Jacques Cousteau said in his beautiful French voice, we protect what we love? How do we get them to know it?
So I'm going to paraphrase the question for those online, which is basically, how do we educate those who go out into the ocean to explore the oceans?
And the decision makers.
And the decision makers. Who wants to kick off?
I'm happy to have a first go. That's a fantastic question. I'm actually doing some work for the Planet Food Forum in New Zealand on their ocean, their mariculture. For me, to be able to do that, I think you have to show the unintended consequences. So if I really want to get my messages across, it's this is the worst case scenario. This is what's going to happen to the habitat. This is how it's going to impact jobs, food, because my speciality is in marine food security. But New Zealand was famous for its no-take zones from maritime. That's where it started from. And I think the work that's been done with some of the Maori communities of how you get the traditional versus some of the more highly regulatory approaches. If I was to come, how do I sum that up? For me, it's about the incentivizing for the behavior. Social capital is very, very powerful. If you get the majority that say, that is wrong to go and poach that species, that is wrong to go and put the plastic or to do that damage. So I think you can take the formal regulations and fines, but I find it's more powerful if people feel the social capital that I really shouldn't be doing that, whether they don't want to be caught or because it's the wrong thing to do. And that is where I think we really need to put the focus on.
Okay, we had a few hands up, so I think it's important to add. Please do put it in. We'll move on and take the next question.
Really positive developments in the ocean space in general from all the UN Ocean Day, international treaties and bringing the oceans and body products. So I just wanted to go back to something you all mentioned in the grants, which was smoke. So I just think about people who have fantastic careers, like what were some of those developments of the course in your careers that were really struck with hope and
I'll go back to the monster example actually, because I think it is an interesting one. And you know, that is there's still a lot of industrial fishing there, but it was the collapse of the industrial fishing in the 30s and 40s. The pollution that they caused, that caused the collapse of it. You know, that environment died because it was overexploited and because of the waste that was created, because the whole web of life just fell apart. And yet, we've now seen it recover to a point where you still see spectacular natural phenomena. And yet, it's still a great access point for people in many ways as well. So I think that is an example of the ocean's power of recovery, which to me I find all the work that is done around the hope spots, for example. You know, I think that again that idea is in many places true, because the oceans do have an astonishing power to recover. But it does depend on us being able to take the pressure off. It does also depend on effective protection. And you know, there are so many, it seems, designated protected areas where protection is ineffectual, which is a real concern.
Okay, anyone else want to add?
As I think you've got that. When I did my dissertation on the effect of no-take zone on London lobster populations 10 years ago, one of the most, I interviewed all the local fishermen, and they all have very different approaches, but what I discovered is that actually fishermen, if kind of briefed in the right way, are the biggest conservationists that we have, because actually they ultimately want to stay their practice and they want to be able to hand it down to their family. So if you can kind of talk to them and about, you will have really good stakeholder engagement, you can talk about the different uses and all that, you can really come up with a good agreement. And actually they are like a really hopeful part of the challenges that we face. And I didn't really touch onto that until I had those conversations. And that was a really special one with me.
Briefly, from being one working with fishermen, asked me where to put some of the marine protected areas. They're very competitive, so often don't want to stay where some of the best fishing grounds are. They came together and they said where all the juvenile nursery areas were. And the fact that they came together, as they were talking about recruitment and the longer term, was pivotal. And the feedback we got was, we understand the science, the longer term as well. And that was quite a pivotal moment for me. Thought, okay, just got to get better explaining the science and consequences.
There's a spectrum, isn't there, in any industry? There's a spectrum in any industry. So you have the good fishermen, and then you maybe have the not so good fishermen. And then you have farming, where you have really industrial farming, and you have those tail low impact farm. And I think that's the thing that we really need to think about when we're tackling these things, that then you can't just put a big black cross over a big red cross over one type of industry. It's a spectrum, and there's parts of the industry that are really good and that are needed and that are sustainable. But it's about how we can then open them, making them available to everyone in a sustainable way.
Okay, I was going to say, if you have a question,
Right, where it's needed to, the first thing here from Boston. Yeah, sure. This is not our industry noted, but also what pick effect is for you then?
We should get
talk to it. Make it fun.
Yeah.
You know, we can be so deep about this, but actually, if people are entertained, then they'll engage. So, make it. Anyone else?
Agree.
Nothing to add. We will
done. And outdoors.
Relatable.
Outdoors.
Relatable. For those.
Relatable and outdoors.
Which would you say is the most damaging to oceans? You've referred to direct engagement with them, resulting in overfishing, pollution, no doubt other things like raising the ocean itself. Compared with land-based activities, which bring about climate change through emissions and similar harmful consequences.
Okay. Anyone?
I mean, what's the most?
I think, I'll have a go. I'm not getting my notes from but I think that we. Are you suggesting that we understand the process of land much better than we do in the ocean, and that people don't see what the services that the ocean provides in terms of mitigating against the climate crisis, the carbon sequestration of the ocean? Is that the sort of thing you're thinking?
Well, that is definitely a great.
Yeah.
That it did seem to me, and this is not a criticism, but you just talked about direct engagement with the sea and the harmful effects of that kind of activity. But there is also the powerful consequences of land-based activities, which produce global warming, which in turn produce movements in the ocean wall, melting of icebergs and so on. And I was just trying to get a grip on which in the long run is going to be the most damaging.
That's all great.
But I think that's why those the international panels for climate change, bringing together terrestrial, aquatic, whether it's freshwater, oceanic, we have to be able to model from all different scales, from different types of impacts. I think the modeling is getting more sophisticated. But I come back to my point about the regulations and maybe your earlier question. How do we change the behavior, whether it is land mining, whether it's plastics? You have to look at it all together. And I think just one area that isn't always looked at is the impact on oceans from groundwaters as well. Doesn't always get picked up. And I would say that, of course, I'm a scientist, but say we need more funding, we need more monitoring. But you think of the size of the oceans compared to land masses and being able to have the scientific evidence of those impacts. It's a very pertinent question because it's difficult to answer. And I would argue that we don't yet have the depth or breadth of scientific data for oceans.
Yeah, I mean, as a bit of a question, again, I would add that a cautionary note that I used to. One is that our observation that the ocean increased incredibly since the early 1990s, and is now on the slope about the ocean. But there's a very little thing below the bottom, and it's worth remembering that. And also, at the problem, I mean, just the scale of the challenge, the range of scale involved, space and time. A lot of ocean currents are much smaller scale than the atmosphere, but the much harder task than modeling the atmosphere to model the ocean. So a lot of this is about risk conditions and remembering what we don't. And I think trying to weigh up the risk, just with the model looks sophisticated, it means right.
And I guess I'm more an empirical scientist.
Yeah.
And especially the benthos, the seabed, there's a lot we don't know. It's very, very expensive doing some of this research, the seagoing research.
It certainly is.
More funding is required.
Okay, there was a question on the back of this here.
Okay, I want to ask on change to behavior that was raised earlier, Russia did sometimes from public conversations with civilians and people outside research. It's like I see a change in the behavior of women telling people they other understand like things like why should we get like there is like the blank is in danger, whereas I have a feeling that most people don't know that it's our species that is in danger. And that the government doesn't care about species, they have like massive like species. So when I'm like, just like telling them that no, it's not the government that is in danger, it's us. So like, I see changes in their behavior. So how much do you think people are aware that of their dreams that they're getting back to? To our generation, what's your impression?
I mean, I think someone's on. Yeah, someone.
You take this.
That's it.
Yeah.
Somebody said something about having the daylight example said about holding, you know, not everyone's going to speak, they don't care that. You talk that if humans are inherently quite selfish, if you can tell them that something is going to affect them, then all of a sudden they want to use it. So the conversations around now that plastics in our lungs have been found in the umbilical cord and in our uterus and in our blood, that
that's actually something that we can engage maybe the population people that maybe weren't concerned about the fact that it was harming our animals and our ocean, but the fact that it's now harming us at that point, actually increasing or encouraging warmth to pick up because of that new science come out. But I think it's there, I think it just depends on what you've been surrounded by, what you've been brought up and what your experiences are in terms of what forces you or teach you into action. And I think, like I said before, I think lots of people, I think humans as well do want to do the right thing, but often they don't necessarily know how to pick action. So again, that whole behavior change has to be matched with tools for them to do so. And playing field is like not level at all for people to take action. So there's a whole work to do there. So yes, let's hit them home that you're gonna, it's affecting you too, but also let's get some tools, really good tools to kind of pull that together. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, anyone else? I think we'll take one final question.
Hi, you mentioned very briefly about deep sea mining. I was wondering what is highly opinion about whether it's a company, maybe the role of the creating or anything like that, but I'm recently there. I think about 900 BCP that was in the cellar through an additional money for all the mining sites. So, do you think how much do these compromises need to be resolved and protect these?
Very unique and unknown
about
that. Thank you. Thank you. But we're almost going to get to the end. Well, actually, similar to other the questions from New Zealand as well. So the work I do for government is very much about marine licensing, not deep sea mining. But the scientific evidence that has to look at the impacts, for me, that's what we have to look at. So the oceans, as I said, are so large. There are some areas where there is going to be less damage, but how do we tolerate damage? You know, is it irreparable, irreversible, or can it recover? So that is where we really do need the scientific evidence. We must have very clear regulations, law, enforceable to make sure that it's not long-term damage. And just understand, because the marine environments are so different. So I do believe that you can have sustainable mining, but you've absolutely got to do all the work, and it requires the benefit, the currents. It requires such complex modelling, which I'd leave David to advise on, that it's important that we consider the impact before, in my view, is considered.
Yeah, I mean, it's my understanding, we don't understand these ecosystems yet, and we might consider them to be totally disconnected from our world, but they're not. You know, you got dwellings from the deep, things enter the food chain straight away. So that world, even that world and our world are connected. And perhaps we should meddle with something we don't understand. Should we?
I was going to say, I read the other day that I think 40, correct me if I'm wrong, she's looking at this, the 43% of our seas are kind of like no man's land in the high seas, so they're not under any country's jurisdiction. So over half of the oceans is kind of, is that about right?
It depends which part of the world, but let's just say there are some conflict and arguments still to be had on some of the on the actual boundaries.
Yeah, so I suppose that's kind of the challenge, isn't it? Like, over, if that is true, that's over half of our oceans, kind of essentially anyone's game. And I think these nets where deep sea mining is becoming the thing that's happening, seems to be people raping and pillaging a bit like it was kind of when things kind of industrial revolution happens, they're just kind of going for it now before this kind of hygiene treaty kind of seems to kick in. And I think that seems to be, for me, for my, that's what the alarm bells are ringing in terms of the conversations have started and they signed a treaty and all that sort of stuff, but they're still doing it ratifying, it's going to take years. And by that point, have we already done the damage that James is talking about?
If I may, there's a lot of focus on not just the Antarctic, but the Arctic. And I come back to that cooperation of different countries and a real question about
does there really need to be mining in the first place?
Actually, that's what they were saying, that almost a lot of the stuff that they're mining, they could actually still be doing on land, but because there's more kind of rules and regulation on land, they're just going for the ocean instead, because it's not quite the rules and the regulation on there.
Okay, so I think we have wrapped the discussion. Are there, if we're rushing in, I would like the panelists for making one share it got so easy, but you've given such wonderful insight and further information about them. I appreciate it. I'm going to hand that to Victoria to that one.